Color party. Quick. March. Color party. Color party will advance left and right. Turn. Color party, hors d'oeuvre, colors.
Ladies and gentlemen, family, on behalf of Royal Canadian Legion Branch 55, we send our condolences to the families and friends and loved ones. I'm just going to read a few things here, and then I'm going to say a little poem at the end. And at the end of the poem, I would like you to repeat after me. I will give you the word. In the presence of the last earthly remains of this, our loyal and true comrade, whose loss we mourn, but whose memory we cherish, I ask you to join me in leaving with him our poppy, which has been established as a symbol of sacrifice and service for the preservation of our democratic way of life. They shall not grow old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. Repeat after me, we will remember them. Thank you, and again, condolences.
Color party, carry colors. Color party, retire right, turn. Quick, march. Color party.
Friends, in our church here at St. David's, we light a memorial candle every time we have lost someone or one of our members remembers someone they have lost in their lives. And so this day, we light this candle in memory of Andrew. We light this candle, and as it shines, we remember the light in his life that has touched us all. And we also remember that as people of faith, we believe that death is not the end, And so we light this candle as well, as a reminder that we believe in resurrection. Friends, we also light the Christ candle as a reminder that Christ is here among us this day. Christ is with us. He is our light that shines even in the midst of darkness. In his life, Andrew heard the call to serve his country. Christ also calls us into service to be his light for the world. And so we light this candle to remind ourselves that Christ is here, to remind ourselves that we are Christ, and that we are called to be light for the world. Friends, let us hear these words of Scripture. From Psalm 121, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. And now I invite Donna to come forward, Andrew's aunt.
When I am down and oh my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden me, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. There is no life, no life without its hunger. Each restless heart beats so imperfectly. But when ye come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think we see eternity. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. Raise me up so I can stand on mountains.
Dear friends, we come together as a community today to remember and to celebrate the life of Andrew Bryan Jackson. We gather here to support each other and to offer Andrew's family our love and our support. We come to shed our tears, for tears are a sign of love and friendship. We come to grieve and to mourn. We come to celebrate Andrew's life and to remember how he touched our hearts and enriched our days. We gather to seek God's guidance and support, God's love and God's comfort. Today, in this time together, may God touch our hearts, comfort our spirits, and may we be reminded that we believe that the human soul is eternal and that there is life beyond death. Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and caring God, in whom we live and move and have our being, we are here today to be with you, to be with each other, and to remember Andrew. O God, we open our lives to you, lives that today are broken and saddened. You know the pain, the loss, and the sorrow that we all feel. Speak to us this day the words we cannot speak to ourselves, words of courage, hope, faith, comfort, and healing that you alone can give through your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. I now invite Amy Green to come forward, a friend of Andrew, to read the first scripture.
So we do not lose heart. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For the slightest momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Because we look not at what we can be seen, but what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens.
Our second reading is taken from the Gospel according to St. John, reading chapter 1 to chapter 6, to verse 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to Jesus, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to Thomas, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Guide us, O Lord, by your word and Holy Spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover hope and peace. Amen. Friends, in our gospel lesson from John, we see Jesus trying to prepare his closest of friends for his death on the cross. And Jesus knows that his disciples, they'll be devastated. He knows their hearts will be broken, their spirits and faith shaken, and he knows they will feel lost without him. He knows that in his darkest of hours, they will flee, they will hide, and even one of them will deny him not once, but three times. He knows that afterwards, they will be filled with regret and with guilt. So Jesus gathers his friends together. He does not want his death to break them. He does not want them to be overwhelmed by grief or loss. He tells them not to let their hearts become troubled. He tells them to believe in God and to believe in him. He promises that he will return. He promises that he will go and prepare a place for them in his Father's house. And he promises them that death is not the end. Many of us today are like the disciples after Jesus has died. They were confused, so are we. They were afraid, so are we. They harbored many regrets, so do we. And they felt disoriented and did not know what to do, so do we. Perhaps as they thought about the time, they remembered Jesus' words day before. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe in me. Today we are shocked by Andrew's sudden death. We're disoriented, we're grief-stricken, and heartbroken. Jesus' words today are directed to us. Believe in God, believe in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus gives us hope, the hope that Andrew is in a wonderful place, the hope that he is at peace after a long and courageous battle with post-traumatic stress disorder, the hope that one day we will see each other once again. And with that hope, we can remember and we can celebrate the life of an amazing human being, a man who offered his life in service to our country. Now, ever since he was 6 years old, Andrew wanted to be a soldier. Andrew joined the Legion Army Cadets when he was 15, and he enjoyed his time in the cadets. When he graduated from Huron Park High School, he went on and studied at Fanshawe College. He left college and in 2006 joined the Army. He did his basic training in Saint-Jean-sur-Richelieu, Quebec, 13 weeks of grueling BMQ. I have no idea what that is, but it doesn't sound good. And he did D1 infantry training in New Brunswick at CFB Gagetown. Training was not easy, but Brian and Joyce assisted Andrew to overcome the challenges of joining the CAF. For his 12 years of service, Andrew was stationed out of CFB Gagetown. In 2009, he served in Afghanistan for 6 months from April to October with his 4th Engineering Support Regiment, 41 Squadron. There, he and his colleagues located and neutralized explosive devices. Andrew was well respected in the Army. He eventually became a master corporal. He was a combat engineer and a diver. When he left the Army, he began his battle with PTSD. It was a hard battle, but he kept working at it. He sought out help. He fought to get better. He wanted to be there for his family and for his friends. Andrew loved his family. He found happiness with Naomi. They were planning to be married. He loved his children, Gabrielle, Sophia, and Luke. His kids were his number one priority. He loved Elliot, Naomi's son, as his own. He played virtual reality games with his kids. He took them to Flying Squirrel in London, bowling and swimming. He enjoyed doing crafts with them and racing remote cars. He loved playing hockey with them or throwing a ball or frisbee. He loved his parents and his sister and brothers. As a kid, Andrew loved working on model airplanes with his dad. But one of his brothers used to love to play with those planes, but I'm not going to tell the rest of that story. Andrew was a talented and diverse individual, and he had many hobbies and talents that brought great joy into his life. Andrew was a talented artist. Andrew loved horses. He worked as a ranch hand in Beaverton, where there was an equine therapy for veterans. Andrew loved dogs. He adored his dogs, Apollo and Maya, his service dog in training. Andrew loved working out. He worked out with his brothers, Christopher and Mark. He shared with them his workout playlists, and they shared with me those playlists. I'm just going to read them out because I don't know who half these people are. He loved Mumford & Sons, Metallica, Billy Talent, 50 Cent, Snoop Dogg, and old school rappers. I'll be talking to the boys later so they can educate me. He enjoyed outdoor activities. He loved to go canoeing, water skiing, hiking, and camping. Andrew enjoyed playing hockey. He rooted for the Maple Leafs. That to me says he has deep faith. He also loved baseball and was an ardent Blue Jays fan. Andrew was a movie fan. He also loved a diverse array of video games. He loved to watch fantasy-based movies and programs like Lord of the Rings or Game of Thrones. He enjoyed Star Wars, Platoon, Full Metal Jacket, and Saving Private Ryan, Lone Survivor, and Black Hawk Down. You may notice a military theme there. He enjoyed reading military memoirs, books on the Navy SEALs, war stories from the Second World War. Andrew had a strong faith. His faith was formed and shaped as a child and teen at Knox United Church in Embro and at Central United Church here in Woodstock. It was at Central United that Andrew was confirmed. His tattoos reflected his deep faith. And you may have seen on the slideshow one on his arm that said, "Resurrected." Andrew loved to listen to worship songs. He had a deep faith and understood that the Christian calling was a calling to serve others. Perhaps this shaped his decision to ultimately serve his country. He wanted to make the world a better, kinder, and above all, safer place. Now, in his second letter to the Corinthians, St. Paul encourages the faithful not to lose heart. He reminds them that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Andrew has now moved into God's house. He has been deployed to heaven, and no doubt Andrew will continue to serve, this time in God's service. Amen. Friends, let us now sing, "Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory."
The glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the fatal night of his terrible sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, is marching on.
I invite Christopher to come forward.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Deuteronomy 31:6. Be strong and of good courage. Fear not, nor be afraid of them. For the Lord thy God, he is that doth go with thee. He will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Good afternoon to you all. I thank each and every one of you truly on behalf of myself, my brother Mark, my sister Valerie, my mom Joyce, my dad Brian, my nephews Gabriel, Luke, and my niece Sophia, their mother Tamsin, Andrew's partner Naomi, and her son Elliot, and the rest of our family for attending today's remembrance ceremony and celebration of life of my brother, Andrew Brian Jackson, or as I like to call him, the OG Action Jackson. I must start off by saying that Andrew had asked me a few months ago if I would stand as his best man in his proposed marriage to Naomi, to which I was quite happy to do so for him. The speech that I have crafted and must now orate this afternoon is a much different one than I was planning for and comes far too soon. However, I am duty bound by circumstance to deliver it to you all today, and that is what I intend to do. We are all of us deeply saddened to our souls and core at the sudden passing of Andrew. And at moments like this, it can be very hard to find explanation or reason as to why and how these events transpired. It can be very hard to remember that Christ is with us always through the good times, bad times, and awful times. He will truly not fail us or forsake us. We have no reason to fear. This is no doubt an awful time, of course. However, that is not what this remembrance memorial will be about. No, Andrew would not have wanted for us to toil in sorrow, regret, hurt, or sadness. He would have wanted much more, much more. I can hear his words now. Bro, at my funeral, I just want everyone to have a big party. It's all going to be just fine. And remember to make it epic. Here's me trying, brother. I'll do my best. This will be about remembering a man who touched the lives of countless people, and though he lived only a short life of 36 years, he accomplished very much in the years that he had on this earth. He was a son, father, husband, and partner. And as it pertains to myself, he was my older brother, my hero, my mentor, my confidant. If I was to recant every memory I had of Andrew, I would be here for a very long time, and you would all be sorely mad at me, having missed some delicious comestibles, as well as a couple of libations back at the Legion. Andrew would, of course, have an undoubtedly long list of snide comments, chirps, and other sorts of verbal jousts for myself, of which I cannot utter here. Do not be concerned, for I do not intend to draw that magnitude of ire from so many well-dressed and fine people. However, while I have your attention, I will pay my personal tributes, respects, and offer a memoir to my brother who has had an immeasurable and quantifiable effect on my life. And quite honestly, I believe will continue to do so through the countless life lessons and moments that I was blessed to share with him. God knew what he was doing in providing Andrew to me as a big brother for many reasons. And he would probably jest in some regard, saying he was cursed with younger brothers such as I. We were 7 years apart, and did I know that as a young boy and consistently use it to my advantage to draw the scorn of my big brother. On many occasions, I saw to it to make a habit of destroying and brutally mutilating Andrew's exquisite jet fighter models, in which he would pour hours of his attention and time into their creation, only to be demolished in a fleeting instance of apparent turpitude by some kid brother. I can only imagine what my brother Mark and sister Valerie and parents had to put up with when they inevitably would be drawn in to these boisterous brotherly bouts of injustice. I knew I would get away with it, though, and enjoyed it far too much. I did apologize to him, though, for these acts of savagery years later. He accepted, of course, and gave me one of his awesome bear hugs, and we carried on with whatever we were doing that day. However, deep down, I believe he was still angry at me for it, and brought it up at times during some of our cantankerous arguments that only brothers can understand. We had so many moments of love, laughter, wisdom sharing, knowledge acquisition, wilderness survival lessons during our camping trips together, memorable family road excursions, athletic and recreational times in which Andrew, Mark, and I would battle it out with our love of working out, pushing ourselves to always be better. It mattered not if we were working out next to each other or apart many miles away. We shared our progress on a weekly basis. We shared moments of sadness together, tough times that either I was going through or he was. He offered me dating tips and meeting girls, and we laughed together joyfully over some of our notable experiences. We all cheered on our beloved Blue Jays and Maple Leafs through their victories and painful losses. We had many hours of playing video games together over the years, and Andrew was a guiding influence on my journey into the world of Half-Life and StarCraft. We all loved our movies and TV shows such as Star Wars, Game of Thrones, and many others, usually involving an exceptional level of violence, themes of heroism, courage, and overall epicness, as we called it. He was a guiding force into some of my musical tastes, which is quite eclectic and diverse, with notable artists such as Sean Paul, Metallica, and Billy Talent, to name a few. Andrew supported myself through all the trying times of high school, the rigors of college and university, and was very happy and proud of my choice to work with the Ministry of Children and Community Social Services as a youth services officer, as well as my volunteering with the Brantford Police as an auxiliary constable, and my role as a mentor with Big Brothers, Big Sisters of Woodstock. He loved it all and routinely encouraged me. We cried together, embraced each other, and no matter what either of us faced in life, we knew that we had each other's backs, no matter what life could send our way. This never changed. This kind of love is what I would define as the purest of brotherly love. And that's who Andrew was at his essence. He was pure. Look no further than that radiant smile stretched from ear to ear that all of us who knew him came to love and simply expected to see. I want to share an example of this pure brotherly love with all of you. I'm taking you all back to the summer of 2002, where we find ourselves on my dad's beloved Doral 1989 bow rider boat at Wildwood Conservation Area, just outside of St. Mary's. I was a 10-year-old boy attempting to learn how to water ski, to follow in the steps of my big brother, as water skiing seemed to evolve into a rite of passage for the Jackson family. I was struggling mightily and could not seem to overcome the initial thrust of the motor, which is necessary to generate the power to literally raise me out of the water onto my skis. I was terrified of the propeller, of the boat especially, and as such, I couldn't mentally overcome it. Andrew, being the protector and leader that he was, told my dad that he would get into the water behind me and stay with me until I can get up onto the skis to assuage my perceived fears. He had my back, quite literally. I did not water ski that day. However, I overcame my fear that held me back. And in time, too, I was able to water ski like my big brother, who I came to respect and love so dearly. It was qualities such as these that led him to carry out such service to those around him as a family man, Gabriel, Luke, Sophia, and Elliot. I know he loved all of you so much. Never forget all he has taught you. Cherish the many beautiful memories that you are all blessed with. I was so happy to see my brother as a father, as he had such a deep, intrinsic love for all of his kids. It was truly inspiring to see. My heart breaks for all of you. His leadership and innovativeness contributed to his decorated career, as a combat engineer and diver during his 12 years of service in the Canadian Armed Forces, especially throughout his tour of Afghanistan in 2009, that eventually saw him rise to the rank of Master Corporal. Truly a man of greatness, love, and loyalty, with a fierce desire to protect all he saw as his own. Andrew, you've taught me so much about these important attributes of the human spirit, and for this I am eternally grateful. In closing, I want to offer a quote from a favorite series of all that all three of us have loved dearly throughout our lives. You might have heard of it, The Lord of the Rings, inspired by the books of the legendary English author J.R. Tolkien, and the films directed by Peter Jackson. There's no familial relation, at least that I know of. However, we're still going through the genealogical history on that one. The scene is from The Two Towers, the second in the trilogy. In the scene, Frodo, the story's chief character, finds himself in a moment of despair in their long quest to destroy the One Ring. He is in doubt and does not know if he can overcome and continue on the perilous journey set before him. Sam, Frodo's closest friend, is posed the question of how they can go on. His response is as eloquent as it is inspiring. Frodo, I can't do this, Sam. Sam, I know, it's all wrong. By rights, we shouldn't even be here. But we are. It's like in the great stories, Mr. Frodo, the ones that really mattered. Full of darkness and danger they were. And sometimes you didn't want to know the end, because how could the end be happy? How could the world go back to the way it was when so much bad had happened? But in the end, it's only a passing thing, this shadow. Even darkness must pass. A new day will come. And when the sun shines, it will shine out the clearer. Those are the stories that stayed with you, that meant something. Even if you were too small to understand why. But I think, Mr. Frodo, I do understand. I know now. Folk in those stories had lots of chances of turning back, only they didn't. Because they were holding on to something. They kept going. Frodo, what are we holding on to, Sam? Sam, that there's some good in this world, Mr. Frodo, and it's worth fighting for. We must also keep going. If there's one thing that I can leave you with all today in tribute and memory to my big brother, AJ, it was his resolute belief in the goodness of people and the importance of perseverance and never, ever giving up, no matter what. You were truly never out of the fight. Andrew, you left your mark on so many and have left a hole in so many lives behind that will never be filled. My hero, my mentor, my confidant, my reservoir of courage when I had none, my inspiration when none could be found, my source of laughs when I was in the dark, howling depths of hell in my own mind. You continue to provide all of this through your own adversity and battles. And that kind of courage, steadfast devotion to love and those around you will never, ever leave my memory nor my actions going forward. Rest easy, brother. With your spirit very much alive, we all will take it from here. And we shall see each other again at the resurrection. Sappers du CERVM, sappers lead the way. In honor of Andrew Bryan Jackson, who continues to lead the way, House Jackson remains strong. God bless.
Thank you, Christopher. I now invite Mark to come forward.
Father, son, brother, soldier, these are the four identities that were and always will be Andrew. At Andrew's core of who he was a man of service before self. I wish to make it known here today that Andrew cared deeply about his identity as a soldier. And this identity that Andrew cared so much about transcends time and space forever and ever. I also wish to make it known here today that Andrew cared deeply about Canada. He cared deeply about democracy. A fair chance for all people around the world to have a chance of living and building a great life and care deeply about Canada's place in the world. Andrew knew democracy wasn't perfect, and we talked about it frequently on drives on the 401 of how it's a work in progress, just like Canada is a work in progress and always will be. He believed in every one of us as fellow Canadians and what we can achieve together when we accept each other, where we are at, being kind, and focus on the benefits of community rather than individual gain. Now, is Canada free of its own dark past? No. Canada is a work in progress, on a path guided only by the beliefs we have in ourselves and the beliefs we have in each other as fellow Canadians. There's not a single day that goes by that I don't think about the sacrifices he and his comrades made to fight for us and continue to fight for us, to uphold the values of this beautiful country that makes it the greatest nation on earth. Values such as courage, strength, unity, loyalty, and liberty. He knew and acknowledged that while Canada was certainly far from perfect, he knew that there wasn't anything that we can't do as a nation if we held true to each other as fellow Canadians and fellow human beings on this beautiful earth. Father, son, brother, soldier, forever and ever. Amen.
I invite Emily, Andrew's cousin, to come forward expressing some words from Ben, who could not be here today.
Good afternoon. Thank you for your presence with us today in remembrance of our cousin, Andrew. Andrew was our big cousin, and we looked up to him. We adored him. He was the kind of person who always made you feel seen, who made you feel cared for and loved. He was very affectionate and tender with his little cousins. Andrew had an infectious love of life. You've heard people already today talk about his smile. We used to receive pictures of Andrew in training in the Army, pictures of all these young men in the forest dressed in camouflage, their faces painted green and brown. And in the middle of the picture was always Andrew's smile, giving away their position like the Cheshire Cat. Andrew had an indomitable spirit, an unquenchable optimism and belief in the goodness of life and the goodness of people. And I think that he got that love of life and that belief in goodness, that ability to carry on from our Nana. Andrew had an unlimited ability to love. He loved fully. He loved everyone that he encountered, and he made them love him. You couldn't help it. That love was infectious, and we will always remember it, as it has marked our lives. Andrew is now at rest with our Lord, who will make all things new, just as he always believed would happen. Amen.
I now invite John Buckle to come forward, a friend of Andrew's from the Army.
I would first like to thank all the Jacksons for the honor of speaking today. To Brian, to Joyce, to Jean, Valerie, Chris, and Mark, and especially to Gabriel, Sophia, Luke, Naomi, and Tamsin, thank you so much for this opportunity. 2 weeks ago, time stopped. Since then, I've been going through memories of a 16-year friendship I had with Andrew. My name's John, and I met Andrew on our engineer training course. We became fast friends. We grew our families together, we lived together, we served overseas together. All this to say, Andrew had a big impact on my life, and I'm happy to share some of those memories with you guys today. I kept asking myself, what's the best way to describe Andrew? And every single time I went to go write something, it came back to love. Andrew had a lot of love. Every time you would see Andrew, he'd let you know he loves you. And I think in the past 16 years, he told me he loved me more than my own parents did. Every time I would see him, he'd greet me by saying, "Hey, Jonas," and he'd give me a big hug, and he'd give me a kiss. Mwah, mwah. When we would leave, he would say, "I love you, man." This was the way Andrew greeted a lot of people, and I think that's what drew a lot of people to him. Andrew had a magnetic personality, and I think it's hard to describe, but I think we all felt it. Part of it was that he never stopped being entertaining. And being entertaining made it really easy to find him if you were in the field. All you had to do was you had to look for the big group of people standing around, laughing and joking, because Andrew was there, doing his best Dave Chappelle impression, telling a great story, because, I mean, he was one of the best natural storytellers I've ever known. And all this gave Andrew a celebrity-like quality. Guys on our engineer course actually picked up on this and started calling him Action Jackson because of it. Although, if you had a bridge to build, you had a hole to dig, Andrew would usually be off with one of these groups laughing and joking. And so that's how he got his other name, Missing in Action Jackson. But as skilled as Andrew was at disappearing at convenient times, he was an outstanding soldier. Andrew had a lot of pride in his service, and it was well earned. Often when Andrew was tasked with any goal, he 100% committed to making sure that it was done. There was no casual setting for Andrew. He committed fully to whatever he had to do. And this focus led him to being recognized as a leader earlier than most. He went on to accomplish great things. Throughout his career, he taught new recruits at the Combat Engineer School. He became a combat diver and he served overseas. But it wasn't just work that he committed to. He was committed to us, his friends and his family. I remember one time in Afghanistan, I found him in his bunk, surrounded by paper. He had a ruler in one hand, he had a pencil in the other. Looked like a college student studying for exams. And I said, Andrew, what are you doing? And he told me. He was responding to a letter his grandmother had sent him. You see, Andrew often knew that he could miss details. And he was going through the letter, line by line, checking off everything to make sure that he was given the letter the care and respect it deserved. And I think that spoke a lot to Andrew, to his character, that he was willing to commit. Andrew also loved talking with his grandfather. We had many great conversations after they had spoke. I learned all about his grandfather's service. He'd go into detail about the history of Afghanistan. It was like listening to a history lecture with all this great detail. And you could tell the whole time how proud he was that he had those conversations with his grandfather. And lastly, Andrew was a person who had strong faith. I loved arguing with Andrew about religion because we did differ on it. But overseas, Andrew was one of the only guys I know that would openly pray before eating, and he regularly donated to the church. One time overseas, our whole entire battle group was staying in a hotel, and I came back to my room to find that Andrew had talked the Padre into meeting me so that he can convince me I was wrong about religion. Because again, Andrew had a strong commitment in everything he did. And so, I know this isn't goodbye, isn't forever. Like always, Andrew will be up there waiting to welcome us with a big hug and kiss. Waiting to tell me he told me so. Love you, buddy.
I now invite Naomi forward to share with us a poem.
Okay. This is from Elliot and I. If tomorrow starts without me, if tomorrow starts without me and I'm not here to see, if the sun should rise, you find your eyes are filled with tears for me. I wish so much you wouldn't cry the way you did today, while thinking of the many things we didn't get to say. I know how much you love me, as much as I love you. And each time that you think of me, I know you'll miss me too. But when tomorrow starts without me, please try to understand that an angel came and called my name and took me by the hand. He said, my place was ready in heaven far above, and that I'd have to leave all those behind that I had truly left. But as I turn and walk away, a tear fell from my eye. For all my life, I'd always thought I didn't want to die. I had so much left to live for, so much left to do. It seemed almost impossible that I was leaving you. I thought of all the yesterdays, the good ones and the bads. I thought of all the love we shared and the fun that we had. If I could relive yesterday, just even for a while, I'd say goodbye and kiss you and maybe see you smile. Definitely see you smile. But then I fully realized that this could never be, for emptiness and memories would take the place of me. When I thought of worldly things I might miss come tomorrow, I thought of you, and when I did, my heart was filled with sorrow. When I walked through heaven's gates, I felt so much at home. God looked down and smiled from his great golden throne. He said, "This is eternity, all I've promised you. Today your life on earth has passed, but here life starts anew. I promise no tomorrow, but today will always last. And since each day is the same, there's no longing for the past. You have been so faithful, so trusting and so true. Though there were times you did some things you know you shouldn't do. You've been forgiven. And now at last you're free. So won't you come and take my hand and share my life with me? So when tomorrow starts without me, don't think we're far apart. For every time you think of me, I'm right here in your heart."
Friends, let us unite our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, you are always near to us. Help us today to draw near to you and to know that nothing can separate us from your love and your support. We come to you through Christ our Lord, who said, "Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." In this and every hour, help us to know your friendship and your protection. Kindle within us the hope that life is not swallowed up by death, but because you live, we shall live as well. O God, let your mercy rest upon this company of loved ones and friends who today remember all that they have received and all that they have given in friendship and in love. In this hour, we remember Andrew for those gifts of mind, heart, humor, and spirit which were uniquely his, and for all the good that entered the world because Andrew was here. Loving God, comfort and counsel those who mourn. Be with Andrew's partner, Naomi, and her son, Elliot. Be with Andrew's children, Gabriel, Sophia, Luke. Be with Andrew's parents, Brian and Joyce. Be with Andrew's sister, Valerie, and brothers, Christopher and Mark. Be with Andrew's grandmother, Jean. Be with Tamsin and Mike. Be with all Andrew's aunts, uncles, and cousins. Be with all Andrew's friends. And be with all those who offer their lives and youth in service to our country. Gracious God, walk with all of us today. Be our guide and our support, our very shepherd in the coming days and weeks. Grant us your peace. These prayers we offer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, following this service, you are invited back to Branch 55 of the Royal Canadian Legion, 642 Dundas Street, for a time of fellowship and refreshments. As we extinguish the memorial candle that has been lit for Andrew, we remember that his life cannot be extinguished in our hearts, that they will be held dear in all our memories. And we remember the words of St. Paul when he said, "Love never ends, and that love always, always remains." And so we extinguish this candle, and we remember, and we will never forget. And we extinguish the Christ candle. Andrew heard the call to service, to serve God
and to serve country. And we are called, who bear Christ's light, to go into the world, to serve others, to follow in that kindness of spirit that Andrew was. And every day that we're kind, every day that we care, every day that we serve, a part of Andrew lives in us. And so we extinguish the Christ candle, remembering that Christ's light is not extinguished, but it lies now in each one of us. And friends, as we go from this place, go and may you remember Andrew. May you remember all that he's left with you. Hold on to the memories. Hold on to life. And go into the world knowing that we are called to love and care for others as Andrew did. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of God's Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you today, tomorrow, and always. And God's people said, Amen.
This
right.